morning. It's great to see all of you here, and I'm really looking forward to today's message. Take out your teaching sheets, as we have a few fill-in-the-blanks this morning, but a lot of scripture to read from. I'm starting a new series this morning, and it's entitled simply Grace Under a Microscope. And we're going to be in here for about 3 weeks through the month of July. The last week of July, we have something very special planned with the children. But over the next 3 Sundays, we're going to be looking at this topic of grace under a microscope. I've really, really enjoyed the last month of going through our series on idolatry. And we broke that up with 2 special services. Our Father's Day service, and then last week our Independence service. But the series on idolatry was so good and so revealing and eye-opening to a lot of us. So important to remember that if there is anything in our lives that we place above the Lord in importance, it really is an idol, and it's idolatry. So let's continue to look at those notes and review those and make sure that we understand that that's really needs a lot of our attention. But this morning we are going to, I would say, kind of take it where I had last left off in that message, because as we explained what idolatry was and the importance of it, and challenging you and myself to look at what could be an idol in our life, we came across the verse that Paul talked about, preached about, taught about in the book of Romans, the 6th chapter, and it is, the verse is right there. It talks about abusing the grace of God, or because we have the grace of God, should we keep on sinning? Should we keep on in our idolatry type of lifestyle? And from that verse, I wanted to transition into the idea of talking a little bit about grace over these next few Sundays. So I'd like to pray and then jump into our handouts, and then we have a lot of verses to read this morning. So turn with me in prayer, please. Father God, we thank you once again for your grace and your mercy in each one of our lives. We thank you that you have allowed us to gather together to worship and enjoy your presence, and now for this time of looking into the Word of God, we'd ask that you would illuminate our hearts as we explore these verses and this example of grace that we see. We pray your blessing now on the Word in Jesus' name. Amen. Before I read this Romans 6, 1 and 2, there is a quote here. Perhaps worse than theological heresy is the effects abusing grace will have on our relationship with God. I'll read it again. Perhaps worse than theological heresy is the effects abusing grace will have on our relationship with God. Over these next 3 weeks, I really want to take a close look at the grace of God. And this morning, scratching the surface about abusing the grace of God. And as I mentioned, that's what Paul challenges us here in these 2 first verses of Romans 6. And, you know, there is a lot of theological heresy, odd teachings that have an effect on our life with God. But I like this quote because it simply states, above all of those teachings that might lead us down an odd path, we need to really focus on the fact that the grace of God is something super special and we should never abuse it. So what did Paul write in Romans 6, 1 and 2? It's there on your handouts. Well then, should we keep on sinning so that God can show us more and more of his wonderful grace? And in this translation from the New Living translation, it says, of course not, with an explanation point. Of course not. Since we have died to sin, how can we continue to live in it? And that is a broad-reaching idea. What is sin? And especially in the area of idolatry, it's easy to see that. And yet this morning, I'd like to, as we take a microscopic, looking at grace under the microscope, take a microscopic look at grace, I'd like to present this idea that it might not even be just this blatant idol that you and I have in our life. It may be, but it's also how we react, how we interchange our minds and our hearts with the Lord as He directs us in our life. So we're going to look at the three or four principles. I'm going to do some fill in the blanks. And then we're going to look at a biblical character, and you see it there on your handouts, and that character is simply Moses. Next week we'll look at the life of Samson, and then the following week we're going to look at the life of Saul. And these three individuals, how their lives interchanged with this concept of grace is what I'd like to spend the next few weeks on. So, with that said, this next quote I have on your handout is, grace is not the freedom to sin. Grace is the freedom to choose not to sin. And I love that. And the reason I use this quote is because you and I have an opportunity to decide how we act and react in every situation in our lives, every moment of every day. And when we come into situations, we need to realize that God is a God of mercy. Aren't you thankful for the Lord Jesus Christ and what He has provided for us? When He sacrificed His life on the cross of Calvary, we have forgiveness of sin. And it's not just forgiveness of sin so we can become a Christian and get to heaven. It's moment by moment. There is a balance to that, and I'll speak to that in just a moment. But once again, Paul says, does that mean we have a license to keep sinning? No, of course not, Paul says. But we have this concept, this principle. I don't like to use the word concept. I like this principle that grace is the freedom to choose not to sin. You and I both understand that our world is in a sorry, sorry state. It's been like that from the beginning of time. Sin entered the world through Adam. Humanity has been dealing with that. You look at history books, and from time to time, we see cultures that are just totally deprived of any kind of moral guidance. You look around today, would you say America and other nations lack moral compasses, if you will? The answer is a resounding yes. We're in a sorry state. And here's a couple of things that we have to deal with. Covet. Covetousness, coveting something. Today, it's praised as ambition. Isn't that interesting? Ambition. If you're ambitious, if you're going after this or that. In a lot of ways, it's covetousness. Greed is admired as being industrious, where you're going and going. Hoarding, commended as prudence. Wow. Premarital sex and extramarital affairs promoted and commended. Think about that. In our culture today, that's exactly what it is. You don't have to go very far to see anybody if they're on their second or third or fourth marriage. It's kind of like the revolving door down at the hotel downtown. You go in and then you come out. You go back in and come around. That's how our society treats marriage anymore. Drunkenness. accommodated drunkenness and effects of vices that we see. Our populace is voting, it's okay, let's just vote for this, vote for this, vote for this, and now it's legal. Because it's legal does not mean it's good. It does not mean that it's right. And yet our society is bought into these situations. So sadly, these and other these descriptions of our society today, not only out there, but they're in the church. They're in Christians' mentality today. And as a preacher of the Word of God, a preacher of righteousness, I would hope that every pastor in every pulpit on this Sunday morning across our country would say something towards this. And this morning, I'd like to continue to address that. And more specifically, Christians, when they get this mentality, they think, it's okay, we'll just cover it up because of the grace of God. It's the grace of God that makes it all right. Titus, Paul writes in the book of Titus, the second book, 11 and 12, follow along as I read it, for the grace of God has been revealed, bringing salvation to all people. What a great verse. And we are instructed to turn from godless living and sinful pleasures. We should live in this evil world with wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to God. So what does the Bible say about this idea that we should live under this canopy of grace? Grace and salvation, you can almost wrap it together. Just briefly, I'm not taking the time this morning. I talked 2 weeks ago about grace, but I love the idea that grace could be defined as unmerited favor, God's unmerited goodness, His favor upon you and I. We don't deserve it. We didn't do anything to deserve it, and yet God freely gives of His grace. This first fill in the blank is that I need to remind us that grace is expensive. Write that word down, expensive. Grace is expensive when we think about it. It cost Jesus His own life. We remember and we celebrate when we take the communion table. Jesus experienced pain and agony. Mockery. He was whipped. He was crowned with thorns. He was pierced on his stomach, and the big thick nails were placed and slammed through and pounded through his hands and his feet. He endured the shame of the cross, the miserable death. We know what that is. And it should remind us that grace is not cheap, it's expensive. So just because it's free, don't think for a moment that it won't cost you and I something. Obviously, and thankfully, we don't have to go to the cross, but it does cost us something. And so it is with grace. On one hand, it's free, as I mentioned, an undeserved gift, the favor of God. And on the other hand, it costs us everything. It requires that we become a disciple of Jesus. We follow Jesus, loving Him more than anything in our life. That's what I was talking about in our series of idolatry. Taking all those things that we've placed above God, we have to tear those idols down and focus on Jesus, live for Jesus. And that is the price that we pay, of giving of our lives and faithfully obeying Him. So, once again, grace is expensive. It costs something. Grace is the most abused gift that Jesus gave to us. Right in, the abused gift, that fill in the blank. Grace is the most abused gift that Jesus gave us. Jesus gives us all kinds of things. It's not enough that an innocent man was beaten and murdered in humanely way for all of humanity. That wasn't enough. He did that for those that were deceased, those that were living, and even the generations to come. It wasn't enough. But he exchanged his blood for this grace. And sometimes we use it as an excuse, once again, to get away from what God wants us to do. That's why Paul says we can't use grace as a crutch to fall back on. It's an abused gift. I use this as a point simply to say, are we abusing the grace of God? As we look closely at grace, do we abuse it? Yeah, we come to church, we worship, we give of our offerings, we come to prayer meeting, we go to Bible studies, we're careful of what we watch on television, we guard ourselves to what we listen to and we watch. Yes, we do all of that. We read our Bible, we pray, but do we really? Ask yourself this morning, do I really guard myself from abusing the grace of God, taking advantage of this? And it really is that concept I titled the series, A Microscope. I'm not a scientist, but boy, I love seventh grade science. You get under in the science room with the lab and you zoom in on the little plate of glass and you're looking at something, it illuminates so much more. That's really what this idea is, taking a real close look. Are we abusing the grace of God? We know as humans, no matter how good we try to be as Christians, we can never work hard enough to please God. We understand that. I hope you understand that. It's not by works that we please God. It's simply by faith and trusting Him in His promises and accepting His gift to us. But with that, that does not mean that we should not be giving our best. Yeah, I get it. We're busy. You got this responsibility, that responsibility, this worry, that worry. That could challenge each one of us to make sure that we are focusing on giving our best, living the Christian life that we've been challenged to live. In a couple of other thoughts or words, we think that we should think of grace as more than a set time or an opportunity to make our hearts right with God, and not a chance to take advantage of it and live as crazy as we can, living on the edge. I love the analogy of driving along a winding road and the idea of sin or not fully following God, and so often because of excitement that life brings us, we want to get kind of really close to the edge. We want to get our adrenaline pumping. We're all a little adventurous. But yet, right on the edge of the turn, if your tire slips, perhaps, on the edge, and there's a drop going way down, why do we want to do that? If anything, common sense would say, go to the other side of the road. Get away from the edge. And yet, we continually live on the edge. Is life boring that way? A lot of people think it is. I don't think it's boring. I love life being in the quote-unquote safe lane, safe side, slow lane, not the fast lane, not the crazy lane, and yet we consistently push ourselves over to the other side. An abused gift can be analogized in this way. Say there's a prisoner in the prison. He's in there for murder, perhaps. And he's on death row. And yet, at a moment, he's called in to the warden's office. The warden says, "You gotta go see the judge." They pack him in a van, he goes down, and the judge says, "You know what? I, as the judge, have decided that you can go free. I've paid the price, or the price has been paid." What do you think that convicted felon would do? Don't you think he would say, "Wow, that's awesome. I thought I was going to have to spend my entire life, the rest of my days here incarcerated in prison. Because, in fact, I was on death row. I was going nowhere. I was actually going to die." Do you think now that he's going to go out and do the same thing that he did that got him in there in the first place? Of course not. Do we have stories of that in novels? Yeah, we do. But if you lined up 10 of these so-called prisoners, what would they do? They would go back and do the same thing. I think that's a great analogy that we need to be reminded to be eternally, every day, moment by moment, grateful for the redemption that we have in Jesus, and not to abuse grace. Third point, yes, we will make mistakes. Write that in. I'm going to make mistakes. You're going to make mistakes. We are going to continue to make mistakes. God knows that more than we do. But I like this phrase, still, comma, let us not purposely, I think there's a fill in the blank there, purposely push our limit and just expect God to forgive us. So good. Let us not abuse the grace He died for by casually doing our own thing. And that so encompasses our life. I'm just doing my own thing. I'm you know what? It's okay. God loves me. We sing it. I got the verses. I memorized the verse. God is love. And yet we go through life just doing our own thing. And this morning I'd like to unpack a little bit of the idea that it's not even all about those idols that we talked about, but it's how we interact with the Lord as He guides us through our life. Day in and day out, we have to be on guard not to just be doing our own thing, but to be cognizant of this idea. Let me read it again. Let us not purposely push our limit and just expect God to forgive us. Let us not abuse the grace He died for by casually doing our own thing. And that's really the theme that I'm carrying over from idolatry and into this thing here. Paul knew of our weakness and stresses the importance of grace. Out of 2 Corinthians 2:19 there on your handout, and he said unto me, "My grace is sufficient for thee." Love the King James here. The reason I love the King James is when I started in Bible college years ago, I used that for quite a while until I got my NIV, New International Version. But a lot of people love the King James because of the power that it brings. Listen to this in the King James Version. He said unto me, "My grace is sufficient for thee. My strength is made perfect in weakness." We need to understand that when we are weak, when we are frail, when we are trying to find our way, it's the grace that is going to sustain us When we have a correct understanding of God's grace, it causes us to yield our spirits to Him. And it causes us to allow ourselves to be molded into His likeness. Many times our minds might make the justification that it's just plain too hard to live the Christian life. So often we do that. Man, this Christian life is just so hard. I kind of give up. Forget it. Thank God for His grace. I'm just not going to work at it. It's so darn hard. Thank God for His grace. And we kind of go through our lives. But we need to remember, God never asked us if we wanted the easy way out. He never did promise us it would be simple. Jesus said, hey, you're going to have problems, but be of good cheer. I have what? I've overcome. Hang with me. I'm the vine. You're the branches. Stay close to me. We can do this. He didn't say it was going to be simple. I remember early on in high school, a couple people told me about Jesus. I knew of Jesus, but they were just really stressed. You've got to really live for Jesus. Your life will be super simple. You know what? That's a hog. Whoa, that's a bunch of hogs. It's not super simple. Jesus never told us it would be like that. And when we fall into those situations, sometimes we just want to throw up our hands. But I want to remind you, he just says, hey, come close to me, and your burden's going to be light. It's going to be well worth it compared to the joy of what's going to be coming. Another verse out of 1 Corinthians, Paul writing 4:17, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight in glory. It's going to be tough, but we've got something great to look forward to. And then this last bullet point on your handouts before we talk about Moses. Jesus has invited us to a higher calling. I'm in higher calling. I love purpose in life. And I want to let you know, you have a higher calling being a Christian than anything else. I believe we need to continually reflect on the change that He's doing in us, this calling, this metamorphosis, if you will, this being changed into His image. Let's start thinking, looking, and living like Christians. I don't know, I have it underlined on my notes. I don't know if that's a fill in the blank, but let's start thinking and looking and living like Christians rather than just say, I'm a Christian, I go to Way of Life Church, or I'm a Christian, I go to this church over here, or I'm a Christian, and I stay at home, and I read my Bible, and I love Jesus. Well, wait a second. Why don't we start thinking? That's the changing of the mind. I love that principle, that by the renewing of our mind, the changing of our mind, our words change. Our actions change, and now our destiny changes. Let's start thinking and looking and living like Christians. This can only be accomplished through His grace and through the strength that grace produces and provides in our life. Again, the theme is let's not take the Lord's grace for granted, continuing with our same attitudes. Same old stinking attitudes. Boy, do we have attitudes. Continue on with our same old desires. Do we all have desires? Yeah, I talked about that in the series of idolatry. We have desires. Do we give in to those desires? Do we succumb to those desires? Or do we say, wait a second, no. And our carnal actions, how we react. I'm going to mention how Moses reacted in just a moment to God's direction in his life. Instead, we need to allow grace to transform us every single day. I have this question that's always gnawed me. I've wondered about it. I'll throw it out to you. Maybe you've wondered it. Why do people still suffer in spite of God's abundant grace? Why do people suffer? We have God's grace. Why do they seem to suffer in this Christian life? Well, the answer is simply because they, And at times, you and I take grace for granted. That's why there's suffering, taking grace for granted. Let's go on to this biblical character. I'd like to spend the rest of my time with this morning, Moses. We all have wonderful, wonderful Bible characters that we all love. Moses is one of the most famous, certainly one that is talked about. Why? How so? Well, this is a great Moses that led the people out of captivity. There's an entire book in the Bible chronically, systematically writing down, actually there's two, Exodus and Numbers, of what he did, of bringing the people out of captivity. And, of course, the great Hollywood movies that have been produced to portray the great Moses, great Bible character. I'm going to read some scripture. You've got a whole page of scripture there. But I'm using the New Living Translation. That's why I tried to condense that. When I prepared the message, I had so much, many more scriptures that I wanted to read. And I had to, for sake of time, it's space reducing. But the ones I have on your handout, I'll have you read along with me, and I'm just going to make a couple of quick notes as we go through, because I believe that the life of Moses, and next week the life of Samson, and the following week the life of Saul, can show us a little bit more of what this grace is like in real time, what it looks like, what it sounds like, how it should function. Out of Exodus 2, the first 10 verses. These are the verses that talk about the birth of Moses. Interestingly enough, I'll just give you a little backdrop of chapter 1 before I read chapter 2. But the Bible talks about the children of Israel settled in Egypt. Part of Egypt, they called Goshen, and they thrive. They continue to grow strong. And the Bible says that there came a Pharaoh that didn't know Moses, didn't know about the people of God, didn't know about their predecessors, Israel and his sons, and he didn't even care. And he realized that they were getting very strong, and he said, "You know what? I don't like this." He made a decree to have all the male babies that were born in Egypt, kill them. He gave instructions to the midwives, kill them. And by doing that, he believed that over time, the children of Israel, the people of God, the children of Israel couldn't get any bigger than the nation of Egypt at that time. I think this into these verses here out of chapter 1. As a little backdrop. But about this time, a man and a woman from the tribe of Levi got married. The woman became pregnant and gave birth to a son. She saw that he was a special baby and kept it hidden for 3 months. But when she could no longer hide him, she got a basket made with papyrus reeds and waterproofed it with tar and pitch. She put the baby in the basket and laid it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile River. We all know this story. Great story. The baby's sister then stood at a distance, watching to see what would happen to him. Soon, verse 5, Pharaoh's daughter came down to bathe in the river, and her attendants walked along the riverbank. And when the princess saw the basket among the reeds, she sent her maid to get it for her. When the princess opened it, she saw the baby. The little boy was crying. She felt sorry for him. "This must be one of the Hebrew children," she said. Then the baby's sister approached the princess. "Should I go and find one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you?" she asked. "Yes, do," the princess replied. So the girl went and called the baby's mother. "Take this baby and nurse him for me," the princess told the baby's mother. "I will pay you for your help." So the woman took the baby home and nursed him. Later, when the boy was older, his mother brought him back to Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted him as her own son. The princess named him Moses, for she explained, "I lifted him out of the water." So that's the actual text out of the New Living Translation of how the life of Moses started. Moses grew up in the palace. I'm certainly sure he, as he got older, he noticed the Pharaoh's enormous power, and perhaps he was spurred on to be a tad ambitious because of watching the Pharaoh. I think he forgot that everything has that concept that we have in Christendom, everything has a time and a purpose, and he kind of jumped the gun. And the Bible goes on to say later that as he grew, he saw an Egyptian who was having an issue with a Jew. He went out and he murdered that Egyptian, feeling like he needed to defend the Jew. And the next day he went out and saw two Jews slugging it out. And one of them said, "Hey, what are you going to do? Kill me like you did the Egyptian yesterday?" And it was at that point that Moses realized, you know what, I'm in trouble. And he decided to leave. He fled to a place called Midian, and he lived there for 40 years. And I made this note. It was there that he was humbled. He lived a humbling life for 40 years. God began to form him. Could you imagine being a prince and now he's a shepherd? Out of verse 11 through 15 and including 21 out of the second chapter, many years later when Moses had grown, he went out to visit his own people, the Hebrews. He saw how hard they had forced him to work, and during the visit he saw an Egyptian beating one of his fellow Hebrews. After looking in all directions, he made sure no one was watching. I guess he didn't look good enough. Moses killed the Egyptian and hid the body in the sand. And then it goes on to talk about the next day. So, it's not on your handouts, but verse 21 says, Moses accepted the invitation to settle with Reuel out there in the backside of the desert, and consequently, he gave Moses, his daughter Zipporah, to be his wife. During this process, God humbled Moses. He revealed himself to him, and then he now told him, it's time to lead my people out. So I'm taking you through this summary of his life because there is always been a nagging question in my life. Why didn't Moses get to go into the promised land? Jump to Exodus 3 and 1 and 2, a couple more verses. One day, Moses was tending the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest there in Midian. He led the flock far into the wilderness, and he came to Sinai, the mountain of God. Then the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the middle of the bush. Moses stared in amazement. Though the bush was engulfed in flames, it didn't burn up. "This is amazing," Moses said to himself. "Why isn't that bush burning up? I gotta go see this. I must go see it." And when the Lord saw Moses coming to take a closer look, he called to him from the middle of the bush, "Moses, Moses." "Here am I," Moses replied. "Do not come any closer," the Lord warned. "Take off your sandals, for you are standing on holy ground. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob." And when Moses heard this, he covered his face because he was afraid to look at God. Verse 7 then says that the Lord told him, "I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their cries of distress because of their harsh slave drivers. Yes, I am aware of their suffering, so I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians and lead them out of Egypt into their own fertile and spacious land. That chapter goes on to describe the land. It's the land flowing with milk and honey. Paints the pictures of what it is. Moses says, wait a second, you got the wrong guy. Who am I? I can't even talk straight. Now, fast forward after this discussion, Moses actually did lead the people out of Egypt. As he led them out, after a couple months being in the desert, he gets the Ten Commandments. In Exodus 19, they arrived in the wilderness of Sinai. They set up camp at the base of Mount Sinai. Then Moses climbed the mountain to appear before God. The Lord called from the mountain, give these instructions to the family of Jacob, announce it to the descendants of Israel. You have seen what I did to the Egyptians. You will know how I carried you on wings and brought you out myself. One of our favorite scriptures. Now, if you will obey me and keep my covenant, you will be my own special treasure from among all the peoples on the earth, for all the earth belongs to me, and you will be my kingdom of priests, my holy nation. This is the message you must give the people of Israel. So continuing on, that's what he did. He went and he said, hey guys, this is the plan, let's obey. He receives the Ten Commandments. I don't have time to read it all, but you can read that in Exodus 20. Continuing on quickly, later the people of God came into a situation where they lacked water. You can read this in Numbers 20 and Genesis 20 and in Numbers 20. I'm going to use the Numbers verses here, but they lacked water. And they began to speak about all the evil things that God had done. They're griping to Moses, why did you bring us out here to die? We're thirsty, we're dying. Why did you just leave us in Egypt? We could have died there, grumbling. And so Moses had all this pressure on him, and it was here that all these experiences that I've talked to so far, I didn't even take the time to talk about how God's grace allowed him to go and do business with the Pharaoh and talk about the plagues, and we see nothing but the grace and the mercy and the favor of God on Moses. And yet he comes to a situation where he cracks. God said, okay, speak to the rock, and water will come out, and people will have water. Moses was still so mad. He even called the people rebels. In Numbers 20, this is where it's recorded. It's not on your handouts, but this story is recorded there. Make sure you take time to read it. Unfortunately, let me read this because it's so good. Unfortunately, this is where we see where Moses lost it. He's God's man of the hour all along, praying for, interceding for God's people. But he cracked. He lost it. He came to a place where he couldn't go on anymore. And I've written down, his anger was exposed. Man, this was so eye-opening to me. Am I an angry person? Do I get mad at God? I believe we all have issues with anger. Do we need anger management? I think what we need is a revelation that we need to guard every thought and every action and every word that comes out of our mouth. Moses was so mad. And that's where his anger was exposed. Calling somebody an idiot is not a good idea. Does that help your conversation? You're angry with somebody because of you idiot? Does that help? No. And that's basically what he did. He said, you're a bunch of idiots. Can't you see this? And in the sight of God, that was no estaba bueno. It was not good. Numbers 20, verse 12 and 13, but the Lord said to Moses there, because you did not trust me enough to demonstrate my holiness to the people of God, check it out now, you will not lead them into the land that I am giving them. What? 40 years of preparation? A couple of years living in Goshen and having to deal with the Pharaoh and going to fight for him and now treading across the desert here, I don't get to go in? I can only imagine what Moses, what his emotions were. The Bible says that this place was known where this water situation happened, with the waters of Meribah, which means arguing, because there the people of Israel argued with the Lord, and there he demonstrated his holiness among them. Preach a whole message on this one verse, this revelation about arguing and anger and how we are to conduct ourselves. I have to believe that if we don't deal with even this one thing, we are abusing the grace of God in our lives. And it's bore out here at this end. It's incredibly sad. Moses only saw the promised land from a distance with his eyes. He didn't enter the land. This was the man that God used in parting the sea. I didn't even have time to talk about that story. What a great story. Oh, man, what a great story. You can read, or for $13.99 a month, you can subscribe to audio. Books online, download the Bible, and listen to a guy in a great low voice talk about dramatically of Moses taking the staff and seeing the Red Sea depart. It's such a great story. But this was the guy. Moses saw that. Moses was the man who prayed, and what? Manna fell from heavens and fed these thousands of people. The Bible said there was 600,000 that left Egypt. That's a lot of mouths to feed. Even Jesus and his disciples had their hands filled. Moses believed God for 600,000 mouths to feed. He prayed and God used him to rain down manna. What a great story. This is what we're talking about. I have to remind you that, yes, the Lord is a God of mercy and grace. God's a God of grace. But he is also a consuming fire and a God of justice. You know the expression, every coin has two sides. God is not all about grace. Is there grace? Absolutely. But we cannot abuse grace. In looking at grace closely, we cannot abuse grace. We cannot take advantage of grace. Why? Because there's ramifications when we do. On the bottom of your handout says this last emboldened thing. The offense of Moses was that he took God's grace for granted. There are other theological positions of why Moses didn't go through, but this morning, I take for this purpose of looking at grace, the reason he didn't get to go in is because of everything God did, he abused the grace of God. So, I'm done preaching. Thanks for your attention. Next week I'm going to talk about Samson. But I want you to ponder what I said this morning. To be thinking about how we abuse the grace of God. Because these two verses out of Romans, the sixth chapter, really hits home. Can we keep living the way we're living? Of course not, Paul says. Let's begin to change our lifestyle, our thinking, the way we live as quote-unquote Christians. Lord, we thank you for your word this morning. We pray a blessing upon it, that it would bring encouragement to us, Continue to reveal to us of what your grace really means. Help us as we take a microscopic, using a microscope, looking at the grace of God over these next few weeks. Bless now your people in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Well, God bless you. Thank you. Have a great day, and make sure you stay cool. It's going to be a warm one.